Now, when we go back to ancient Egypt, to ancient Canaan, and for the record, the blacks of Canaan were the one who gave the Jews. Well, I won't say they gave it to the Jews. I think the Jews took it. They were responsible for the religion, the language, and the culture, and so forth, all the Jews. You see? These African people were the ones that were responsible for civilization. And when we reach back to them across the ages to find out what did they know, what did they accomplish that can help us out of the misery that we're suffering today, that can help us to liberate ourselves, we find the most important message is that, you see, before you can do anything, you must know yourself. You see? And by self-knowledge, I'm not talking about yourself as a black man, I'm talking about yourself as man, okay? Once you understand yourself as man, then you can understand yourself as a black man. And I'm saying, when I say man, I'm speaking in the general term. And once you understand yourself as man, you can then understand your enemy. And until, you see, you have understood man, you will not be able to accomplish anything in this world. So before I speak about the way out of this, because the Holocaust that, you know, that we are suffering was foretold in our ancient scriptures. Okay? We have books that were written thousands of years before the Hebrew was even born. Before Abraham was even born, we have thousands of scriptures that we wrote. You see? And when we take the time to read some of these scriptures, the Perkum Heru, for example, the Zeshem Duat, we discover that there is an understanding of man that is so profound, you see, that will enable you to avoid and solve all problems. You find that there was a prophesizing of what was going to take place today and the way out of it. So let me first go to the board here, because we're going to need some visuals to follow this discourse, and so that I can refer back and forth to the basic principles. I hope that those of you on this side can see it. I need to write more to this side here, so hopefully you can all see it. If you cannot see it, I would prefer if you could just move over to this side here, okay, because I need a space to the right. Okay. Okay, here we have a simplification of one of the most revolutionary pieces of insight that has ever been created by man. This is the tree of life. You cannot practice medicine without a science of anatomy and physiology. Without anatomy and physiology, how could you refer to the heart, to the veins, to the capillaries? You with me? You have to have an understanding of the structure of the body. before you can understand and explain what is wrong and how to fix it. You with me? You cannot speak about the Spirit if you don't have an understanding of the various parts of the Spirit. This structure here we call the tree of life. It is called the tree of life. For the simple fact that, you see, it is a classification system upon which we can classify all the things that exist in the world. Once you study this and you master this system here, you will discover that everything that exists can be classified in one of these 10 spheres. Okay? It has been used to classify the faculties governing man's behavior. Okay? The parts of man's spirit. Until you understand the human spirit, you cannot understand what makes man behave the way he does. Okay? Before I explain it, let me go to one more little diagram here to show you why this is important. That little wavy line is water. The little peak jutting up above the water is the top of the iceberg. What's beneath is the bottom of the iceberg. You're familiar with that, right? Okay? This is symbolic. The top part, C, is symbolic for the conscious mind. The larger part is responsible for the subconscious mind. You see the difference in the size of the two. What we mean by that is that the subconscious has greater weight, greater power in your life over the conscious part of your being. The conscious part, that little puny little part tipping off above the water, is where you wish, where you express your desires, where you will for things to happen. You see? This biggest part beneath there is what controls what is going to happen, is what decides what is going to happen in your life. Suppose you want freedom. You see? Your wanting freedom is expressed in the conscious part of your mind, that little part up there. But the power to achieve freedom is in the subconscious part of your mind. Suppose you want to be happy. You want to be wealthy. You want to be in possession of yourself. You want to be self-disciplined. Okay? You want to give up bad habits. You want to achieve what you will achieve. You are expressing it through that little puny part above the waterline, but that big part beneath the waterline is going to determine whether you will get these things or not. Now, what we mean by subconscious is that it is that part of your being that decides what you are going to be in life, and it operates outside of your consciousness. It operates behind your back. It operates without your consent. It operates, you see, without your control. There is something that operates outside of your awareness, without your consent, without your ability to directly intervene with it, you see, and determines your life. It is subconscious. Suppose somebody, perhaps your enemy, has full knowledge of how to program your subconscious for you. Do you know people who say, you know, I know smoking is bad for me, I want to stop? The little part on top says, I want to stop smoking. And this big part beneath the waterline says, no, you won't. The little part on top says, I'm going to give up chocolate cake. It's bad for my weight. I'm going to give up, you know, fat. you know, I'm going to have a heart attack. And the big part beneath the waterline says, no, you won't. The little part on top of the waterline says, I got a good wife and children. I better leave Mary alone. You know the rest of the story. You know who's the boss. You know, the little part on top says, African Americans earn $400 billion. It would be good if we could come together and spend 1% of that in one place. That would give us $4 billion a year. That's more money than most countries have. You see, that would solve our problems. $4 billion a year, we could fund every single program that we need to fund and still have money left over to take care of indigent white people. But then that part beneath the waterline says, no, you won't. You see, that part on top of the waterline says, we must unite. We want to unite. But the forces of disunity is down here in that big part beneath the waterline. You like the person who knows what to do behind the wheel of a car. But you don't know how to get down underneath the hood of the car. You know what I'm saying? To fix it when it stops on you. Because you have no insight as to what all those wires and tubes and things are all about. Now, let's talk about those wires, those tubes, those nuts, and those bolts. You see? If you try to look into, if you try to go through the re-baptism, meaning subversion, consciousness beneath the waterline, to look into, discover what is it that makes you the way you are. If you try to use the European concepts, you know, subconscious mind, id, ego, you know, super ego, and so forth, you are going to end up no better than Sigmund Freud. Don't read a man's theory, read his biography. When a man comes to you and tells you, I want to teach you how to control yourself, how to understand yourself, read his biology. Biography, I mean. When a man tells you, I want to give you religion, read his history. Uh-oh. Is it? Now, our ancestors were the masters of withdrawing consciousness from above the waterline and taking it down into the underworld, the duat, the subconscious. You see? To discover what is it that was beneath that under, beneath that line, that waterline. They want to find out what are those things that make us the way we are. You see, we concentrated on understanding self. Because we believe that the genius of the nation should be dedicated to making a better human being. There are people, other people, who take all the genius of the nation to make a better mousetrap, or a better computer, or a better car. This is a better thing. Not a better person, but a better thing. And then you fall into the trap of defining civilization by the ability to make a better thing. You see? I have seen the future according to the white man. It is the year 4000 AD in a galaxy far, far away. You know, traveling at warp speed. Still victimized by anger, lust, killing, murdering. You know what I'm saying? The white man, you know, dream of the world 4,000 years from now hasn't progressed one step ahead of the animalism. Come on now. I do not want to go that way. When it says integration, I say integration to what? People walk up to me and jack me up after I finish a lecture. Shatner, you've been talking about all these words of power and these spiritual things and about God. What about guns? I said, guns don't kill people. Guns don't liberate people. People have to use guns. If they're going to use guns, it is people who liberate people, not guns. So if you want to liberate yourself before you reach for guns or not, maybe you may have to do these things. I don't know. But you first have to understand yourself. You see? So let us understand ourselves. Let us understand, why is it that we earn $400 billion and can't spend, you know, 1% of 1% of that in one place? That is sad. Because, see, if we already earn $400 billion, we're already liberated. We're already free. If we earn, we need to call what we earn, you see, the black GNP. That will make us top, put us in the top 10 leading countries in the world. And nobody has put a gun to our head and say, hey, don't spend 1% of it in one place. And you know something? We spend about 10% of it on tobacco. We spend 10% on it on something that somebody went out and killed 100 million of us to enslave us to grow tobacco. And we spend 10%, we spend, if all I'm saying, $40 billion a year on something that was used to enslave us. We spend about 20% of that on alcohol. That's why they snatch us out of Africa. To grow sugar, to make booze, to grow tobacco, and things of that nature. You see? We don't have a civil rights problem in America. We don't have a human rights problem in America. We have a spiritual problem. It is true that they owe us reparations. It is true the man is wicked. But we got the power to liberate ourselves. We have already been liberated ourselves, but we don't know how to take advantage of our liberation. That is what we have to understand. Why can't we even realize that we are already liberated? Because, you see, understanding is controlled by the subconscious. You can look at something day in and day out until the subconscious throws up to you the association. You won't understand what you see. You see? Now, let's move on. Your spirit. If you don't study the spirit, and somebody asks you about the spirit, you can't break it down. If you ask the African, what is ear? He says, well, they don't know what ear is. Ear is ear. Isn't it? If you ask the European, what is ear? He said, well, it's so much percentage carbon dioxide, so much percentage nitrogen, so much percentage oxygen, and oxygen does so and so, and nitrogen does so and so, and carbon dioxide does so and so, and then there are these inert gases, and he gives a whole numerical breakdown of what ear is. You go, wow, the man studied ear. He can break it down. You ask an African, what is water? Well, water is water. You ask a European, what is water? He can break it down. 2 molecules of hydrogen, 1 of oxygen. Hydrogen does so-and-so, oxygen does so-and-so, has a molecular weight of so-and-so, atomic weight of so-and-so. He can break it down by the numbers. He can tell you what ear is composed of, what water is composed of. You ask the European, what is the spirit? He says, spirit is spirit. The same way we can't break down air because we haven't studied it, the same way he cannot break down spirit because he hasn't studied it. You have to understand these things. Otherwise you fall into serious traps. End up falling a child when it comes to religion. The white man, I define religion in my meditative And I've told white people everywhere I've gone, you don't have religion. You don't know what religion is. And none of them have disputed me to this day because they know it's true. I explain that later on. Now, when you study the spirit, you find that your spirit is a complex being. In the same way your body is complex, you see, you have a cardiovascular system, a respiratory system, a urinary system, a digestive system, and so on and so on and so on. It is complex. And the understanding of these different systems and what each one does enables you to practice medicine. You with me? You can therefore speak about the different systems and what they do and diagnose what is wrong and prescribe and all this is because you have a broken down knowledge of the body. You see? So you to understand why you are the way you are, you must have a broken down knowledge of that entity that is responsible for your behavior. And that entity responsible for your behavior is your spirit. Okay? Some of you say, no, it's a psychology. Wait a minute now, what is psychology? The word psych, yeah, is a name that the Greeks gave to the sahu part of the spirit. This, yeah. Yeah? When the Greeks came to Egypt, they were given this broken down knowledge of the spirit. You see? And they call what we call the cab, they call the cab, you know, I'm sorry, the kaibit, they call the kaibit the zoo, yeah, animal, spirit, right? Okay? They call the sahu the psyche. Okay? They said that the pneuma, P-N-E-U-M-A, was in the zoo, the animal spirit. What we call the ebb, and the ku and ba and so forth, they call the numina. He said, they didn't have all the parts, but they had names for different parts of the spirit as well. You see? If you ask the Zulus of South Africa, they also tell you that the kaiba, the animal spirit, is the unzimba. You see? You find that the, what we call the sahu, they call the idlozi. The, what we call the ebb, they call the uti, with muntu. And so different cultures have this knowledge of different parts of the spirit. Because they have made a study of the spirit. So the Greeks, when they came to Egypt, they had different names for different parts of the spirit. You see? But when the European so-called intellectual, scientific-minded person wanted to discuss the shaping forces of human behavior in such a manner that he would not be accused of speaking spirituality, you see? He took the word psych for the sahu part of the spirit, you see? And just simply said, well, this is psychology, the study of the psyche. You see? Well, so he's studying the same thing, meaning that psychology is the study of the human spirit. But you have this problem where you forget the origins of things. And I just want to give you the version to show you how wicked it is because it was brought to my attention earlier. I had a little chat with sister who just been walking down by the river. By the estuary out here, and I reminded him how, you know that child's song, ring around the rosy, a pocket full of, you know the children sing that, right? And they all fall down. Well, you know, ring around the rosy were the little pox that the Europeans got when they had the Black Plague. They would break out into these pox, you see? And they would stink, so they had to put poxes in their pocket, you see? And ashes, they all fall down because people with the Black Plague, they'd be walking in the streets and just fall down. And they were so infected that they would burn them right there, ashes. You know what I'm saying? So that's what children be singing, right? And you'd be teaching your children to sing those songs, right, haven't you? You see, you don't even inquire as to, well, what am I teaching my child to sing here? You see, European mentality is full of the use of things that you don't know what they mean. You don't even have a sense that you ought to know what they mean, and so on and so forth. If I ask, you know, all of you, what's the meaning of your name? Many of you would say, I don't know my name doesn't have a meaning. But names are supposed to have meanings. Names have meanings. Be careful. Your problem could be that the meaning of your name is taking us quickly in the whole wrong direction. Whoa now. You know, you might have a name like fish. Or beer. You know. You say you might want to be a doctor, but your name is Smith. You know, and you don't understand why you keep wanting to go back to working with your hands. You know, working with banging on metal, you know. You know, the Smith, you should have been called something else. You got to understand that things have meanings, and you have to deal with meanings and purpose. I'm just simply saying to you that the Western man has his habit of hooking into words without understanding the meaning of the words and let alone the reality behind the words, and we were, you know, taken away from our culture. And then now we are given his inferior culture in place. And that is the beginning of our problem, because all problems begin with the mind. You see? And the solution to all problems must be affected in the mind. You see? Now, so psychology, if you understand that psychology is the study of the psyche, you see? And it has to do, it's just simply one of the parts of the spirit according to the knowledge of the Greeks, you see? And they ignored all other parts. They understand that it's really the spirit that you're studying, because you see, those people who formed the word psychology, you see, are studying the same thing, spirituality. So if you're a psych major or a sociology major, and you're not going back to your African ancestors, it has a complete knowledge of the spirit and how to affect it, you see, then you cannot rescue your people. Okay? And psychology and sociology are failures. Look at the world today, and you find that the white man doesn't know how to shape human behavior in a positive way. So you have to scrap that and study history and ask yourself, are there people that history can reveal to me that were able to establish, you know, stable societies? You find them in Africa. You find them among the American Indians. Then go and study their psychology. They call it spirituality. Now, when a man looks into the spirit, he's able to break it down into its different parts. Quickly, we have the carb, which is the name we give to the body of atoms and molecules that you call the physical body. Okay? It's not the material body. Everything is matter. You see, matter comes in different degrees of subtlety and density. You with me? On some level, matter, you see, is particle. On another level, matter is force. You with me now? Okay? And if you study the Bantu philosophy, when Placid Temple, just with priests, went to South Africa to study Manu Zulus, you find that long before Einstein was born, to explain to white people that force and matter were different polarities of the same thing. You see, the Zulus told the same thing to Placid Temple. You see? Because the name for matter is Kintu. You see? And Kintu is a category for all particles and all forces. I think Einstein read that book. He had the opportunity to read the book. And he was an avid reader of metaphysical things and other cultures, so I think he read the book. You see? Now, when you study the spirit, you find that it has these different parts. The cab is a body of atoms and molecules, a part of the spirit that you can bump into on earth. Above that is the kybit, what we call the animal spirit. The word animal comes from the word animation. You see? Animals are not the critters that run around and fly around and creep around. Animals is that electromagnetic force, intelligent force in nature that allows things the power to move. As you say, E, motion. Yeah? As you say, motivation. Suppose you're saying, I have a problem being motivated. You're saying, if you understood your spirit, you were saying, I have a problem with my animal spirit. And then if you understand that the animal spirit is controlled through breathing, then you will know that the solution to your motivational problem is just to engage yourself in deep breathing exercises. Very simple. You don't need, pep talk and rally. No, just breathe more. Get some fresh air. You're motivated. Can we use more motivated black men and black women today? There you go now. You see? But it's animal spirit. That's why in ancient Egypt, you saw hawk-headed humans, dog-headed humans. You know? You saw cow-headed humans. And the white man would come and say, you people are worshiping animals. We weren't worshiping animals. We were saying something that psychobiologists just discovered about 50 years ago. That in the human brain, there are animal structures. The brain stem and the limbic brain is an animal brain. These are animal brains. The brain stem, is what influences the behavior like a reptile, because it's the part of your brain that you share in common with reptiles. The midbrain or limbic brain, makes you behave like the beast and so, because that's the part of your brain that you share in common with the beast. So you have something in your brain that makes you to act like an animal. If you don't understand that, you will not take measures to tame the animal inside of you. And then the animal will control you. But worse than that, somebody else, your enemy, will control the animal for you to control you through the animal within you. And you will be writing poems and singing songs, glorifying the ways of the animal within you. Listen up now, I'm telling you. Turn on your radius any day and you can find your fallen saints. People writing songs, worshiping the animal within them, because if you don't know, better understand that. The animal within you, the caibic part of your spirit, is that part of your spirit. You see? That says to you, this is what you like, this is what you don't like. This is what you like, do it. This is what you don't like, don't do it. You know, you like hamburgers. The white man says, let us make them love hamburgers, so that we would kill off all the black men in the prime of their youth. By the time you hit 50, 60, you're finished. Because you'd be going down eating hamburgers with all that fat in it. You see, he said 97% fat free, but he didn't tell you that it's enough fat in you to kill a horse. You see? They know where high blood pressure comes from. They gave it to you. They know where it comes from. You see? So we want for you to understand that somebody is pushing your buttons. If you don't understand the nature of your spirit, you see? That which likes within you, that which expresses itself as liking, moves you towards something or moves you away from something, is a blind, dumb animal principle. Do not ever do something because you like it. Do not ever recede from doing something because you don't like it. Because then you are in control, then you're being controlled by the animal spirit within you. On a scale of values, look how low the animal is. You're eating very low off the tree of life. Sahu, spirits 9, 8, and 7, the Sahu part of the spirit. The Sahu part of the spirit corresponds to 8. The 8 spirit really classify your ability to handle, verbal symbols. You process verbal symbols through the 8 spirit of the spirit. That's where you give a name to a thing, a definition to a thing, a description to a thing. You with me? All schooling is giving names, descriptions, and explanations about things, you see? Now, this is what happens, though. When you use what you call your intellectual abilities, C is the reality. B is the intellectual symbolic representation of that reality C. You with me now? A is you. And every time you want to know the reality C, you go through the symbol B. So no matter how nimble-minded you are, no matter how many PhDs you have, you see, you are never looking directly at the reality C. You are looking at the symbol B. You're always looking at something that represents something that's standing in for the reality. And no symbol, no matter how well constructed, can contain reality itself. This is a trap. Because your enemy has figured out how to hide more reality than he reveals through symbols. Let us understand that. There is a science of the spirit. When you bring your consciousness to reflect onto the tree of life, when you see, the symbol, the verbal symbol processing faculty is down here, 8. Yeah? If you were to bring your consciousness up in the second sphere of the tree of life, you will gain the ability to shut down the thinking ability. There is a state of mind where you have no thoughts. All thinking vanishes. And you end up looking directly at the reality without a word trying to explain to you what you see. So that's one of the biggest traps in life where words are explaining to you what a thing is and is not. You have to be able to still that process to see exactly what is out there in the world. You see, this is what you mean by liberation. Are you with me now? Okay? The man has woven a very complex edifice of ignorant words in order to control you. You know what I'm talking about. How many people believe in democracy does not exist? You with me? You see, if you were able to spill the thinking processes, you would find that capitalism is a failure. You see, but many of you are going to school to try to make it in a capitalist world that has failed. When capitalism was invented, they said it was to give wealth to the people and to the world. Then how come is it that every single nation is in debt? How come is it that every single nation has such a debt that they can never pay back? Well, but you're going to go to school tomorrow, Monday, huh? They said the Greeks invented democracy, but the women couldn't vote in Greece. You see, that's what happened by the, you know, people don't see the reality. See, they see the symbol for the reality itself. And I can go on all night long, I can just spend about one thing and pile up examples of that, but I know you're bright, you got the gist of what I'm saying. Let's move on. Now, so the Sahu part of the spirit has this problem. You see, it cannot see reality, it can only see the words, the definition, the description, the information that represents reality. You see, you don't see God, you see the explanation of God. You see, you know about God, but you don't know God. But you walk around thinking you know God, because you mistake, you see, being informed with knowing. You see? When you shut down the thinking principle and you look directly into the world, you see, you know. But when you are having an information explaining to you what the world is, you don't know, you're just simply informed. Informed. You see? knowledge that has been put into form. But that knowledge could be wrong as hell. It usually is. You see? Not by accident or by ignorance, but by design of your enemy. So I'm trying to build up very slowly to let you understand how to liberate ourselves. Because you see, for you to liberate yourself, you have to reclaim your mind. Because you see, it is a war in the mind. The greatest general, the greatest military strategist, you know, Chinese man by the name of Sun Tzu, in his book, The Art of War, said, to defeat your enemy, you must first defeat your enemy in the mind before you strike the first blow. And perhaps you may not even need to strike a blow. The seventh fear is your artistic ability. You see? The eighth fear corresponds to your ability to, you know, to process the world verbally. You know, all your induction and deduction and logical thinking and so on and so on. And it's the left side of the brain that thinks verbally. The right side of the brain that thinks pictorially and graphically is the seventh fear. It is the sahu part of the spirit. You see? And people who have not risen above 7, 8, 9, and 10 are what we call the sahu man. You see? Those make up the majority of people in the world. Very quickly, the Ev man, 6, 5, and 4. You see? 6 is the ability to, you see, to direct yourself, the will. You see? It is Heru in the Hermetic tradition. It is the ability to control yourself. You see, the sahu man is controlled by the kaibe, likes and dislikes, pleasures, displeasure, right? The sixth spirit allows you now to resist, you see, your likes and dislikes. Okay, when your sixth spirit is fully established, now you resist the animal within you. You have the power to resist the animal spirit within you. You with me? So the Ev man that has a 6, 5, and 4 developed is able to resist the animal. So therefore, he can now be moral, the sahu man. You see, who can use information very cleverly and very well and so forth, you see, is still controlled by his emotionality. That's why you find scientists, doctors, you know, PhDs, who still smoke, who still eat meat, who still eat things that are harmful to them. You see? That's why you find people who follow their feelings. Okay? That in itself is not a problem. It becomes a problem when the sahu man now sits in the seat of government, in the seat of academics, in the pulpit. Then is when it becomes a problem. In ancient Egypt, in ancient Taoist China, you could not sit in the seat of government, in the seats of the pulpit, or academia, unless you were an Ev man. You see, if you want to benefit from Kemetic wisdom, you have to understand that there is a way of analyzing human behavior. You see? And objectively establishing, you know, what faculties, you see, correspond to what levels. The fifth sphere is your sense of, you know, justice. You see, the justice that you call upon yourself. When your fifth sphere is developed, you will have the strength, the moral strength, to not benefit at somebody's expense. That's what justice is. You see, justice is not punishing the wrongdoer. Justice is you not rising at the expense of somebody. Like you invest $50,000 in a new widget. And then you find out that this new widget causes cancer in people. But you say, well, let me keep quiet. At least let me make my $50,000 back. You with me? Plus 3% for the time that I'm putting into it, and then I take it off the market. You with me? That's what we mean. You see, you don't have the strength to take a loss. Justice is having the strength to take a loss, you see, when gaining or surviving will cause somebody else harm. That's what justice is. The fourth sphere is the ability to understand the interrelationship and interdependence between all things. See, the black man, for example, understood the interdependence between men and women. That's why you go back all the way to ancient Africa when they were doing, whenever the black man is doing his own thing, you see, there is a sharing in government between men and women. There is a sharing of power and wealth between men and women. Okay, the white man, you see, has never been able to do that. Because he lacks that ma'at principle. The ma'at is the fourth spirit of the tree of life there. When you have the ability to understand the interrelationship and interdependency in things, you see, then the ebb part of the spirit comes into being. So the people who will govern, you see, have to be the people who develop the sixth spirit, meaning heru, the will, the ability to control the lower part of being. Take a man like Colin Powell, descendant of Jamaicans, right? He was the one who was in charge of Panama's invasion, right? The invasion of Panama. Okay? And then many of the black people that were killed there were descendants of Jamaicans themselves. Listen, take this other guy in Washington that was caught with the cocaine or the crack or whatever in the hotel. In ancient Egypt, the man could never govern. Ted Kennedy, all these fools out there could never sit in the seats of government. One of the problems why we cannot, you see, come out of this hole that we are in is because the people, we have not been able to establish among ourselves, you see, a rule of giving recognition only to those black men and those black women who have brought forth the ebb part of the spirit. The hero in ancient Egypt is the sixth spirit. Heru. The word hero comes from the Egyptian word Heru. You see? In the so-called mythology of Egypt, Heru is symbolic of that part of the spirit, the personification of that part of the spirit that is fighting against evil to reestablish the kingdom of, you see, of God on earth. That is the hero. But we make heroes out of Michael Jackson. We make heroes out of Magic Johnson. We make heroes out of Prince. We make heroes out of a whole bunch of people who, you know, are controlled by the animal part of your spirit. That is why we have 400 billion and don't know what to do with it. Because we have, you see, we don't know how to establish. You follow what I'm saying? But we're learning. We are learning. We have to go back to the ancient Kemetic wisdom to establish the new values and paradigms for what, how we're going to redefine the black community. We don't have a community. We don't have a community yet. Community means a common unity. Okay? We have a common unity when we spend our monies together. You see? When we spend our monies for one another, then we have a common. Common unity is not living in the same hood. There's something wrong about that word, the neighborhood. Some brothers took that literally. We have the Osir man, composed of the Ba part of spirit, the Ku part of spirit, the Shechem part of spirit. The Shechem is that part of spirit where you have the power to use words, you see, to act upon your spirit to affect nature. You see? There's a way of going into trance with certain words. Your ancestors were able to classify what sound does what in nature. If I'm hopeless at mathematics, I drill, I'm going to see. You see? I'm hopeless at physics and chemistry. The math part, the technical part, always swamp me. I can chant the song, aing, 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 in trance. And after several weeks or months, I will become a mathematical wizard. Don't believe me. Learn how to meditate and work on that chant. And come back next year and tell me if you're not a mathematical wizard. That's all you have to do. You see? But if you want a little encouragement, then go to your physics manual, and your physics manual will tell you that sound generate caloric energies. And heat waves
precipitates and speeds up chemical reactions. And all of your mental processes have a biochemical basis to them. And each sound, according to its own, you know, wavelength, has an affinity for a particular function within your brain and your body. So the same way the white man broke down, this element does this in nature, combined this way and so forth, your ancestors said, this sound does that, and so on and so forth. We have 23 out of 24 women who the doctor said could not get pregnant who are mothers now, because they went into trance for several months or years with the sound tang, T-A-N-G. We have many people who suffer from, came to us with arthritis, with warts, with migraine headaches, you know, with all kinds of physical and emotional illness, who are free of those illnesses because they took into trance the sound tang. We have poor people who are now well off because they went into trance with the sound shereen. Yes, there's a sound that makes you impoverished. Some of you are poor because of the sound of poverty that constantly manifests itself in your spirit. How many of you hear sounds, a ringing sound in your ears sometimes? Can I see some hands? Look at that. Now, how many of you are sure that the sound that you are hearing is not the sound of poverty? You better start in this thing here. Some people, if you're pessimistic, it's because there's an active principle of pessimism manifesting itself within you. If you want to be optimistic, you cannot talk somebody into being optimistic. You cannot talk somebody into being moral. Morality is a flow from a force within you. This is the greatest message of ancient Egypt. You see? Everything flows from a power within you. I take people who want to be good in music, I give them the song Clean. Or they want to paint, I give them the song Clean. You see? In 1982, we had to marry 22 couples. Because several years before that, about a year or two before that, we gave them the song Hoon String. Now the women chanted Hoon String. They came together and they were meditating. They would burn some cinnamon. You see? You get to know the right things to burn. Y'all be going to the store buying, you know, honeysuckle and all. No, burn cinnamon. Go to the supermarket, burn cinnamon. Put on a yellow and green dress. And five yellow roses in your room and chant string on, string on. And when you finish, put on some orange blossom oil. And all of a sudden the man has been ignoring you for years. Physics will tell you everything moves, nothing stands still, right? The laws of physics. Everything is in motion. And you know that whatever moves makes a sound. And if something is not moving enough and you know the sound it makes, you make that sound and you make it move some more. Go up the piano. You know, lift the top up, you hear nothing. Huh? Put your foot on the rightmost pedal and sing a note. Ah! And you hear the sound come alive in the piano. The string was at rest and it begins to vibrate in unity with the sound that you've made. The same thing is with every faculty within you. Anything that any other human being does, you can do. The problem is that power is slumbering within you, and you have to awaken it. Those words, those are key words, slumbering and awakening. If you've been studying Kundalini yoga, you find you have to arouse and awaken Kundalini. It slumbers within you, they say. You with me? You know, if your eyes are open, you have to be awakened. The whole thing about spiritual development. The whole thing about developing yourself is awakening slumbering powers. It's not about pumping information into your head. Let me tell you something, right? From preschool to your 12th PhD, all the information that you receive goes into the eighth sphere. That's the faculty that you see processes some verbal, symbolic information. But you know that because you know people with PhDs that are miserable, that have no control over themselves. You know psychologists with PhDs that have no self-control. You know that. Which means that there has to be something higher than being informed. You know the person, maybe yourself, that when you do wrong, you know you're doing wrong. But something, you can't help something. There's something, there's a helplessness about you. If all I'm saying, you don't need a sermon, you don't need for someone to tell you you're doing wrong, you know that already. You heard the word, you read the Bible. And that's a problem with African Americans. We go to church more than white people go. That's a fact. It's scary. Down south, we'd be standing out in the street, even raining. On a Sunday morning, we out there outside of the church. The church is packed already. We outside standing in the street in the rain. You get me? And then what is happening? We're still suffering the horrendous divorce rate. We heard the good word, but we still can't hold our marriage together. We heard the good word, but we still can't raise our children not to go off with crack and teenage pregnancy and things of that nature and killing each other. We cannot get, you know, we go to hear the good word, but we cannot get something to keep our lives from falling apart. At the end of World War II, we had hundreds of thousands of acres of land. We don't have that land today. But we went to church every Sunday. What happened? I want you to understand is that words by themselves cannot save you. You have to awaken the dormant powers within you. It boils down to this here. The psychologist says that in most people, only about 7% of the brain is active. The other 93% is slumbering. You know, nature did not make that part of the brain to be wasted. You see, the white man never takes up the subject, well, now that we have said that, let us now go to the real. How many of you ever read that, by the way, right? That 93% of the brain is sleeping. Common knowledge. But do you ever ask yourself, well, where's the chapter on how to awaken it? When I read that, I flipped the book. I wanted to find out the part on how you awaken it. I didn't see a single reference to it. I closed the book down and said, you're a fool. You know what you're talking about. It seems to me that psychology has to be how you awaken that other 93%. Because I concluded right then and there that my problem is that the biggest chunk of my brain is sleeping. You know, I put two and two together. There was a little percentage that was awakened enough to let me know that it says, all creatures survive by their brawn, and human beings survive by their brain. True. Which means that if we could use the other 93%, we would be in good shape. Our ancestors of ancient Egypt figured this out. They figured this out. That's why, while the ancient Egyptians were civilized, building huge buildings, rerouting rivers, building artificial lakes, you know, Amenhotep III and those guys, those kings, those pharaohs, they built lakes, artificial lakes. Even Amenhotep built it for his queen. He didn't have to, he just built it for his queen. That's how powerful these engineers were. You see, little children in Sumer, 5,000 years ago, long before Pythagoras was born, little children, black boys and black girls, were struggling with the Pythagorean theorem in school. Little boys and girls like this boy and this little girl in ancient Egypt 5,000 years ago were struggling with quadratic equations. The rest of the world was still chasing sheep. Black people were chasing sheep then. The Chinese man was chasing sheep then. While we were, living in a, an ancient civilization, mature and ancient. Why? Because we discovered how to fully awaken the brain. Let me explain to you something. Sound is the key. Every part of your brain responds to sound. Go back to your books on psychobiology. You find there's a brain stem, right? The brain stem deals with your arousal and your awakening. It's a conduit to wake up the brain. It is called the serpent brain, the reticular cortex or the serpent brain. Listen carefully now, right? That is why, in ancient Egypt, the father of the gods and of all humans is represented by a serpent around the sun, Ra. That is why in Black India, the key to all liberation is the awakening of the serpent power, Kundalini, within you. That's why among the Dahomeans, the key to all rhythm and power is the arousal of Dambadawedo. The symbol is the serpent, the serpent of wisdom. Because it's a serpent brain in the back of your stem. This little part in your brain here corresponds to, it's a small part of your brain, but it makes up 98% of the brain in reptiles. You with me? That part of the brain is the most primitive part of your brain. It controls the major part of your emotional behavior. And that part of the brain, if you ever try to talk and train a reptile, if you ever have a snake pet or a lizard pet and try to train it, you can't train it. You with me? Because the reptile brain within you does not respond to words. It responds to sound. Listen, your ancestors worked out the science of how to use sound to awaken all the structures of the brain. What I'm saying to you is that we don't have to wait for white people to share knowledge with us. We don't have to wait for white people to give us anything. We have the keys that our ancestors used to create the ancient civilization. And we can recreate submission once more again. Because, the great prophets of Egypt understood that nothing moves in a straight line. Everything moves this way. Everything is cyclical. Everything, human beings, nations, everything, is born. Waxes, matures, has its splendor, its day in the sun, and then loses its vital force, and then goes down and dies to be reborn again. People say, if Egypt was so great, how come it was destroyed? There's a day that will come that this boy will walk up to Mike Tyson and whoop him. That's what I'm talking about. It was there that my cousin would be a little decrepit old man. And this little girl too can look him. Every nation comes, rocks and so forth. So the ancient Egyptians, they saw that their nation, before I'm saying, will die one day. So they built what they call houses of eternities. The great pyramids and the great temples, and they buried as much as they could with the dead. In all kinds of secret passages in stone, in the mountains and things of that nature. Why? Because they knew that they too as a nation will be reborn sometime in the future. You with me? may not understand it yet. You may not have the courage to say it yet, but I tell you verily that you are the ancient Egyptians who have come back. You understand what I'm saying to you? But your weapon is the weapon of the Spirit. You have to believe in spiritual power. That is the great lesson of Nelson Mandela. Without a Kruger gun to his name, without a gun in his hand, if all of a sudden they could have snuffed his life out at any time. But they feared him. They feared his spirit. For 27 years he defied them, and they had to let him go. All he had in that jail was his spirit. Whatever was it that he learned in his rite of passage as a young boy, he said, is what defeated the whites of South Africa. And I want to tell you something. You see, it was not the white man who killed Hani. Yes, a white man pulled the trigger. But it was not the white man who killed Hani. It was the ancestors. You see? Because you're going to find out that before this year is ended, that there's going to be some traumatic changes in South Africa because of the death of Hani. You see? See, Hani was holding on to the youth, containing them. He had to be moved out of the way by the ancestors. Let the youth go. The ancestors were the vehicle, the vessel that said, this has to change. You know what I'm saying? Mandela right now is also holding on to the youth. But it is too late. So, let us, now that we have a little understanding of who we are and the powers within us. And by the way, every single one of these faculties, right, has a word of power. Take for instance the second sphere, the Ku. You see? The Ku part of the spirit, which is the wisdom part of the spirit, will allow you to solve any problem that is in front of you. For example, how to liberate yourself. If your Ku was awakened, you will intuitively find the right strategy. You with me? You can awaken that power by chanting the word HUM in a state of trance. H-U-N-G, HUM. You see? And you don't have to pay TM for these words of powers. We gave it to them and we are reclaiming them. They are free. They belong to God. Let no man, no woman sell these words of powers. You see? Some people might say, well, but you also gave it to the white man. Forget it. He can wield these words of powers. Because, you see, so before you can wield these words of powers, you have to cross the fourth sphere. You have to be justified in truth. And he is not. So, you see, we can spread out the wisdom in front of our enemies. And they cannot use it against us because, you see, their heart does not belong to them. He said, you can verify this teaching in the Platinum Heru. You see? To wield the words of power, you must live truth, you must be justified in my art. Pure and simple. Now, let's now that we understand ourselves, let us understand our enemy. Your enemy, our enemy, has not risen above the Sahu part of the sphere. The eighth sphere, Sebek, you see, is his master strategist. The eighth sphere is the symbol processing faculty, the myth-making faculty. You see, he weaves the illusion of power. You see, with clever words. His greatest weapon is cleverness. Ho Chi Minh saw through that, said, you're a paper tiger, and defeated him. You see? He said to you, you follow what I'm saying? Wealth is in money. You see? Not as money, first of all. Before we explain what money is, let's understand how money is generated in this world. You know how you get money, right? You work for it, right? What some of you hold up people for it? Well, that's work too. That's work too. You know, but and it's different because the white man prints it. That's the main difference here. You work for your money, he prints it. Will he ever share the printing press with you? You have to understand your enemy. You have to understand the nature of the problem confronting you. You see, he will never share that printing press with you. You see? So therefore, let's just talk about integration. That's the beginning and the end of the talk of integration. You say, I'm 10% of the nation, they give me 10% of the printing presses. Pure and simple. Give me 10% of the, first of all, then I say, first of all, you might say, well, the government prints the money. Let us first shatter that myth. The government does not print money. The Constitution said that only the government, Congress, shall mint money. That's what the Constitution says. Right? The one who prints the money in America is the Federal Reserve Banking System, which is not a bank of reserve, but a bank of issue. It issues money. It does not reserve money, it issues it. It prints it in violation of the American Constitution. You see? But you can bury Sahu Man under a ton of verbiage. So that's the nature of Sahu Man. Okay? Let's understand that very clearly. So who is the Federal Reserve Bank? It's a group of 12. Okay, and the reason why there's 12, because we're dealing with occult things here at this point now. It could have been 11 or 10 or 30, it had to be 12 member banks. You got to understand that very clearly. Why there were 12 disciples and 12 tribes and 12 sons of Jacob and 12, you understand this, what are 12 wishes in the covenant, things of that nature, you can understand these things. If you don't understand that, then look at your dollar. It's a talisman. It's a magical seal. Okay? You can put it on an altar and light candles and say things, and things appear and manifest themselves with that. It's a seal. Okay? If you don't understand that, you stand up in front of any official of the law and burn a dollar bill in front of them and they'll lock you up. If it's your dollar, why can't you burn it? If you understand occultism, then you understand that you hurt certain spirits by burning your seals. You know what I'm saying? But anyhow, what I'm saying to you is that, you see, these 12 banks are private individuals who own these banks. Okay? The power elite that own these banks. So many of you, don't raise your hands, some of you are, you know, majoring in finances and economics. The beginning and end of economics is being granted the power to print money. That's the beginning and the end of economics and finances. Being granted the power to print the money. Okay? Otherwise, you're dealing with crumbs. You see? You're getting a PhD in how to handle crumbs. It's a game that they're playing with you. If you want to liberate yourself, you're going to have to understand the nature of the enemy. You have to understand the nature of the man who is in control of you. Every single major war in the past 300 years was fought over, you see, the control of that printing press. You see? The American Revolution, the American Liberation, was not over a tax that was less than 1% of the GNP. This so-called Boston tax or whatever on tea. That was less than 1% of the GNP. You see? That was a drop in the bucket. It was not about taxation representation. If you understand, you see, you know, how the world works, the master principle in work is economics. In the white man's world, that is. The master principle in the white man's world is economics. Economics defines the political system. You see? The American War of Liberation was fought because the colony, American colonies, was printing its own money. You remember that? Yeah? They were printing their own money and they were doing good. The Bank of England said, you cannot print your own money. Your money must be, you must borrow the money from England. Your money must be based on the English money. So all of a sudden, for every single American money that was printed, the American colonies was in debt to the Bank of England. You see, here are free people that were making money and prospering, you see, became automatically in debt to the Bank of England, to the Rothschilds, the Red Shields, okay, the Five Arrows. Don't understand why these things are that way. You see? And they went to war to have the right to print their own money. That is what the War of Liberation was all about. You see? Hitler went to war. Mussolini went to war. You see? Francisco Franco held out as well. You see? Russia backed out. Japan went to war to control their own banking system. That's what it's all about. I'm not saying that Hitler was any better, but what Hitler did not want, he said, well, why is the Deutsche Mark in control on Wall Street and in London? No way. That's what World War I, World War II was all about. That's why right now Russia is getting ready to have a civil war. Because, you see, the people that are against Yeltsin, you see, they know what's going on. What's going on right now is a taking over, if all I'm saying, of the Russian banking system by the Bank of London. Because even the Bank of London controls America to this day. America is still a British colony, if you don't understand that. Because all the investment houses and Wall Street are controlled from London. That's the relationship between Bush and Margaret Thatcher, between Clinton and the Prime Minister of England. They always run to get their orders from the Prime Minister of England. You gotta understand these things. But you see, as long as, you see what, you see the power of the white man is in keeping the population on the Sahu level. See, this is where the power comes from, in here. It's a tyranny built on illusions, illusion woven through symbols, through words. The way, only way out of this madness, the way to liberation, you see, is for you to institute rites of passage among yourself and your children, to bring the consciousness of your people up into the air, part of the spirit. You must give birth to Heru again. That is the way out of this. He gives you the illusion, for example, that money, that wealth is in money. If I were to give every one of you $1 million, listen to this, the whole world here, and you all had $1 million, there would be none of you who would be wealthy. If the prices of things remain the same, and we give each one of you $1 million, nobody would be wealthy. Because if each one of you have $1 million, who will serve you? Who will shine your shoes? Who will take the garbage out? Who cuts the garbage in the streets? You see, wealth is an artifice. You see, wealth is the artifice of creating a distinction in class. The health, yeah, wealth comes into being when there are haves and have nots. So wealth, you have to have an artificial means of creating a large number of have nots, that they will do the menial work, so that those who have can sit back and enjoy themselves. That is what wealth is. It's not in the money, it's in the illusion of it being in the money. You see, for there to be wealth, you see, the majority of people have to be impoverished. You see, if I give half of you in this room here $10 million apiece, you're right. The first thing that many of you will go out to do is to spend that money on buying the coercive force of the other half of the people in the room. You with me? Right? You know, I give $10 million for people this side of the room, right? One of you will spend that money, you with me, to buy up the people over here to go take the money away from those over here. So power is not in the army. Power is not in the gun. You see? Power, you see, is in the hands of the people. But for there to be power, you must be kept ignorant about why you're fighting and what you're fighting about. It boils down to being kept in the Sahu Father and Spirit. And to do that, you see, the man who controls you have to create an alliance between you and the animal spirit within you. The servant spirit, the servant spirit, the god of Heferu. House of what? We call her Heferu. Hep is a house. Heru is the hero within you, the liberator within you. Yeah, the will. The will is that part of you that will liberate you. Heferu is the house of the will. You see? Your will has to be nourished by your sexual vitality. That is why, you see, every, you know, martial artist conserves sexual energy. That's why every liberator, Mahatma Gandhi, he will conserve their sexual energy. That's why in every spiritual culture, when the yogi, the sage, the whatever is going to do something major, they conserve their sexual power. When they want to control a people, they addict the people to wasting their sexual vitality. They will allow you to get rich singing songs about how sweet it is. You know, how you can't do without it. I know it because I was once a songwriter. I was making lots of money myself. You follow what I'm saying? Before I became raw and nothing of men, I was Broadway Reggie. Yeah, I had songs on the charts. You know, I had records on the charts. I was making money out there. I knew the game. I knew how to write the songs. You know, the rhythm, the lyrics, you know what to say. And you write for the women. Not for the men, you write for the women, always for the women. You know what I'm talking about. Any songwriter knows how to make money. They will pay you to enslave the minds of your people, get them to drain that sexual power away. But if you understand the comedic wisdom, the sexual energy is the highest expression of the life force. You see? If you want those men and women who are going to be the liberators, will have to go through a cycle of conservation. You know what I'm saying? But when I say conservation, I don't necessarily mean not having sex. There's a great tantric wisdom of how you can have sex without spilling a seed. We have to go back to this kind of knowledge.
That's right.
You see, we have to pull the plug on the television, on the movies, you see, and spend more time now, you see, understanding how to empower ourselves. Empowerment is not pouring information into your head. It all goes on in the head there. Liberation is raising consciousness. Consciousness flows through these different spirits of the sphere of life. You see? It's a raising of consciousness. We find that, you see, since liberation has to do with freeing yourself of the symbolism, the words that have been used to enslave you, we find that the most potent weapon of the enemy is religion. Religion. The black church is the biggest financial enterprise in America. Yet they do not use that money to liberate black people. If the church was doing the right thing, let us go back and, you know, understand how easy it is to destroy Sahu man. Anybody ever read the Old Testament? People walk up to me and say, Shechem, do you believe in the Bible? I say, yes, I understand the Bible. Or I might say, no, I don't believe in the Bible, but do you understand the Bible? You see?
Did I finish up here? 1, 2, 3, yeah? Oh, yeah.
Okay. So the whole thing then is that when you read the Old Testament, you find that the Old Testament was about a people who were disunited and were, you know, they were now brought into different clans and tribes to give them a sense of nationhood. You see? You're the tribe of this, you're the tribe of that, the tribe of the other, and so forth, but all these tribes are one nation, the nation of Israel, the Hebrew nation. You with me? So the Bible speaks about how, you see, people will come together to get a land of their own, because, you see, these people, when the people of the Bible came to Western Asia, once they Palestine and Israel and Syria and so forth, these lands were already occupied, they were already taken. You see, when Abraham came, all the lands were taken. You see? So the Old Testament is how the people would come together and form a covenant with God, and then God will help these people take the land away from those who have it already. Okay? So if you understood the Bible and you were living by the Bible, you would use the instruction in the Old Testament to unify yourself, you see, and establish a covenant with God to get land on your own.
Atlanta, maybe, with Mississippi.
And throw Texas in too. But the Christians don't understand the Bible. Why? This faculty, the eighth sphere of the tree of life, that processes verbal information, it works through the left side of the brain. The left side of the brain, you see, looks at the world and focuses on how things are different and separate from each other. So it loses the relationship between things, you see? The left side of the brain, you know, is unable to connect things with each other. So the left side of the brain reads the Bible and cannot unify the information. You see what I'm talking about? So the white man capitalizes on this weakness of the Sahu part of the spirit. You see? To enable you to read something, live by something, and keep you from understanding, you don't understand what you're reading. That's what the Old Testament is all about. How the people without land can get land of their own. That's the theme of the Old Testament. If you believe in it, then you will be using the book as a manual of political activism. The New Testament is a different story. Because Jesus did not write the New Testament. Jesus wrote nothing. He was a griot. He spoke. oral tradition. Well, he wrote nothing. So who wrote the New Testament? You have to inquire into who wrote the New Testament. You see, who established, you see, Christianity? Jesus was not a Christian. He was a Jew. He was a rabbi. And by the way, you know, to be a rabbi, you have to be married. Does that explain why everywhere Jesus spoke, Mary Magdalene was there? Does that explain why when Jesus comes off the cross, after death, he comes up in the bed, right? Who was he going to see? But Mary Magdalene. He didn't go to see one of the disciples, Peter, or Mark, or Luke. He goes to see Mary Magdalene. Why? As a Jewish rabbi, if you were not married, that would have been one of the biggest accusations that the Pharisees had brought against him. And at the wedding of Cana, why does his mother, Mary, ask him to replenish the wine for the guests, if he's at the host of the wedding? The man was a Jew, a rabbi, meaning that if he were alive today, he'd be celebrating Passover and Hanukkah, not Christmas and Easter and things like that, you see? He was a Jew. The Christianity that you know was created at various councils in Nicaea by the Romans. The Romans, you see, were, you know, imperialists. They were slave masters. And they wanted, you see, a think tank. They wanted a doctrine that would enable the people that they had conquered to be receptive to being conquered. Right? If I slap you, turn the other cheek. Don't fight back. If I want to steal from you, give me your shirt. Off your back. They said, this is love. Wait a minute. If you got a problem and you're murdering and you're stealing and I hold your hands and I even cut your hands off if you can't help yourself, that doesn't mean I don't love you. I'm keeping you from losing your soul. I'm helping you stop in your track of wrongdoing. You see? I mean, stop and think about it. It's that love thy enemy. First of all, what makes a man your enemy? He's raping your women? You know, I mean, turn the other cheek is symbolical of whatever you want, give it to him. That's what it means, right? If you raise your woman, give him your daughter. You know? And maybe yourself too, because he goes that way too. I mean, what makes a man your enemy? You know, I mean, let's look at the history, right? He raped our women. He killed 100 million of us to enslave us. He destroyed our culture. You know, he stole our land, the wealth of our land, impoverished our people, reduced us to barbarism to the point that black men are killing black men. You know, now AIDS is rampant through our community. He has reduced us to a life of inhumanity and barbarism. That's what makes a man your enemy. So what do you mean that we should love him? What do you call loving him? That we should, you know, if I understand love from our answer, that love is giving, seeking of in return. So that means that if he is raping and maiming and killing us, that we should give him more of ourselves to do these things? What is it to love a man who is doing the thing that makes him your enemy? You can't come up with anything that makes sense, can you? You can't come up with anything that makes sense, but that's the nature of the Sahu. The Sahu part of spirit, you see, cannot see the reality itself. It can only see the words, the information that supposed to explain to you the reality. You see, Sahu does not respond to reality, it responds to words. The white man understands this quite well. He knows this very well. You see? If a man is raping your women, undernourishing your children, let me explain to you something I learned in studying the white man's books on psychology. He took, you know, some rats over here and allowed these rats all kind of contentment. And these rats remain healthy generation after generation after generation. He took another group of rats from the same litter and he would mortify them. You know, keep them cramped up, underfeed them, bother them, hit them, make them, you know, upset all the time. You with me? Abuse these rats. They live in close quarters, they were biting each other, too close to each other. And that went on for three generations. After the fourth generation, the rats began to have high blood pressure, cancer and higher. These rats will commit rat and rat violence. He did animal experiments to get the model of what to do with us. You see? Because we know that if there are drugs in our community, we are not big players. We don't grow the drugs. You see? He can stop the drugs any day in a strike. He knows every single country where they grow the opium, the poppy seeds. He knows every country where they grow the coca plant. He can go put his navy right on their front door and say, either you stop growing these things or we will not let a single plane or ship into your country. That's the end of drugs in the world. Understand that. Now they got a black man's going to be the drug czar. It's here again. You see, we have to interdict, you follow what I'm saying, the flow of drugs. Come on, you don't interdict the flow of drugs, you stop the drugs at the source. Part your navy, you follow what I'm saying. Put one ship off the coast of Colombia, you follow what I'm saying. One ship off the coast of Peru. You follow what I'm saying? One ship off the couple of ships off the coast of Indochina, whatever, and says, nothing comes in, nothing comes out if you keep growing the poppy seeds and that coca leaves. That's it. We'll shoot anything out of the sky. That's the end of the drug traffic. If you don't burn up all your coca leaf plantations, you will get nothing will come into your country. The way that they told Saddam Hussein. The way they have been, you know, blockading Cuba for all these years, they can blockade every single drug-growing country in the world. If United Nations was really about, you know, truth, all of these crackers would come together and part the navies around these countries and stop the flow of drugs. So why are the drugs in the community? Now, the majority of people in that community are not doing drugs, but you're still the victims of the drugs. You know why? Because the reason for drugs is to have you live in tension and in stress. Yeah. The man discovered that if you keep a population of animals or people in chronic stress, their IQ drops, their problem-solving ability drops, their power drops, all the good things in their life is diminished. So, you follow what I'm saying? You see? So, it's not that you're doing drugs, it's that you're living in fear. You're living in tension, in stress. Because there are drugs in your community, and you have been told, you must not take the laws into your own hands, you can do nothing about it. See? That's the diabolical genius of the enemy. You have to know yourself and your enemy. But you know something? Suppose every African-American understood the powers of meditation. Suppose every single African-American began to meditate at least three times a week. So at least 15 to 30 minutes, three times a week. We will cure ourselves of that stress and that tension. I have lots of brothers who have come and meditated and said, man, that tie felt so good. This, no crack can touch it, no marijuana can touch it, no cocaine can touch it, just the powers of sound and deep breathing. You hear what I'm talking about? If you flood the streets with meditation, if you become meditation Christians, what you say is tension versus relaxation. Tet means peace, but peace is that state of relaxation that nothing can upset. You see? Every ill that comes to you is based upon tension. The white man knows that. And he devises all kinds of ways to keep you in a state of chronic tension. That's why we're trying to get you to meditate. That's not simply for the power that can come out of it, but for you to understand that, you see, there's a diabolical plan to keep you in a chronic state of tension. As soon as some white kid sees some shooting or something, right? They run the psychiatrist, right? To give them, you know, the therapy. You see it around TV, right? Little white kids experience some little violence or something, they have these people come and give them some psychological counseling. You know what I mean? Our children see killings every day. You know what I'm saying? You've been laying in your bed and dodging bullets in your own bed, coming to the window, so forth. Have you seen one psychological counselor come into your neighborhood?
No.
Do you understand this is not by accident? It is by design.
Yes, sir.
I'm telling you, you create the habit of meditation in the black community, and you'll find that crime will go down, illness will go down, productivity will go up, creativity will go up, unity will go up. Because, you see, it is not about information, it's about raising your spiritual power and your consciousness. Because, you see, your spirit already knows. Your spirit already has the knowledge of what to do to solve your problems. The problem is that things have been contrived to keep the consciousness in the lower part of the spirit. They push sex, they push drugs, they push bad food upon you. You with me? If the man wants it to really make money, he will push foods on you that cost more. Right? You know what I'm saying? If he wanted to make money, he would push health foods in the black community. How many health food stores are in the black community? I mean, you know, brown sugar, natural brown sugar costs more than white sugar. If he wants to make money, and you know he wants to make money, then he will saturate the community with health food stores. But instead he gives you junk food stores, he gives you liquor stores, because he wants to keep you devitalized. Because he knows that there is liberation in health. My consciousness began to raise automatically and naturally when I changed my diet. People say, how do you come to this? You know, just bear with me a few minutes. I wanted to be a he-man. You see, I'm a little man. So in 1992, when I got out of high school, I wanted to be a he-man. You know, tired of being pushed around by the big guys, you know? So I read a magazine about that Joe Wade and stuff. So I went and I read the magazine, and they said that there was this store called a health food store. I don't know what the hell it was. I was back from the ghetto. I was 18 years old, didn't know what a health food store was. I mean, I'm serious, right? I was 18 years old, didn't know what a health food store was. You know, they said this store in Manhattan, Flyers, goes out to be Brooklyn. Traveled for 45 minutes out of the ghetto, out of Manhattan. All this, like, wow, man, look at this place. You know what? You know, to buy this stuff. All of it was chocolate and a lot of sugar to make me bulk up, you know, and so forth. And it cost like $40. I was like $45 on the table, my money. I go to this store, want to be he-man, you know? I'm ready now, walk into this store, you know? help so-and-so. And I walked in and looked around and said, vitamins, milk. I said, wow, what is this kind of stuff inside, you know? And there's this book on the shelf called Feel Like a Million by Catherine Elwood. Little pocketbook for 95 cents. Cost about $3 a day. So I took the book off the shelf and flipped through it, and the woman was talking about, you know, how vitamins can make you healthier and brighter and da-da-da-da, and how the lack of these vitamins and how you white bread was no good because you don't have any vitamins. I'm like, wow, yeah. I read about these things in school. I heard about vitamins in school. But this woman's talking about how they're good for you and how the lack of it is bad for you. I said, let me buy this book. It's only 95 cents. So I bought the book. I went across to the library, you know, in the park, and I read the whole book because, you know, I'm master speed reading, you know. For about an hour, I read through the whole book, like 300 pages, you know. I make notes. Rose yeast, desiccated liver, powder, vitamin A, wheat germ, you know. And I went back and said, I forgot about being a he-man. I wanted to be healthy. You know, so I bought men like 40 months worth of stuff, you know, brewer's yeast, tiger's milk, you know, wheat germ, desiccated liver, went home, poured everything in the blender. A little bit of this, about 15, 20 different things. I did that and took a healthy swallow and almost died. The stuff tastes awful. I said, okay, but I'll work it out, you know? I'll work it out. You know, got a girlfriend, you know, say, cook this up for me. But my consciousness changed along the way. You see? The tenth spirit, the calf, the animal spirit. You see? Your animal spirit, you cannot control it. Other people can control you through your animal spirit as long as, you see, the animal within you is wayward. The animal spirit within you, the body of emotions and desires becomes incontrollable when your diet is full of sugar, nicotine, marijuana, cocaine, too much salt, when you devitalize yourself with too much sex. You see, when there's not enough grip, fresh air within you. Why do you think that the white neighborhoods have all these trees and the black neighborhoods lacking in trees? You see, because they understand that trees produce oxygen. They don't want you to have oxygen. You see, trees produce ionized oxygen. Trees strip electrons from the oxygen so that the people in the white neighborhood can be more vital than you are. Everything is well controlled and so on and so forth. My brothers and sisters, the Panthers ran me out of the temple back in 1960 when I first came to this country. When I first came, I went into one of the things and, you know, the offices in Bedford-Stuyvesant in Brooklyn. Coming, having been born in Panama, and being a member of the Federation of Panamanian Students, being nourished on the teachings of Pablo Neruda and Ho Chi Minh and Che Guevara and the Red Book of Mao Zedong and Soviet Nation, and being part of a country that was into, you know, liberation of its people, I sat down with Panthers and I was speaking to them in New York. And I said, wow, brother, you are heavy. You should be our information minister. I said, well, if you make me information minister, the first thing we have to do is get rid of all that tobacco and wine and marijuana. I said, first of all, you see, you are making your enemies rich. You see, at the same time, you're decreasing your power to fight the enemy because these things are making you sick. Can we find the spiritual power to get all black people, instead of spending money on tobacco, to put it in a black United Fund? Can we get all black people that every dollar you spend on Coca-Cola and Pepsi-Cola and the On-Cola to put it in a black United Fund? Can we get every single black person who spends their money on alcohol, Coors, you know, Rheingold, whatever, Schlitz or whatever, you force a light beer or heavy beer or whatever, to put the money into a black elephant? Can, before I'm saying, we have a spiritual problem. The solution to the problem is spirituality. My brothers, my sisters, you must understand something. A wise man once said that the first thing that you must learn in life, if you want to accomplish anything in this world, is the knowledge of self. And once you acquire the knowledge of self, there is nothing else in the world that you need to know. Thank you very much. Time for questions and answers.